I think everybody is struck by this very special quality of this place. It's a combination of things. Yes, it's the morning light, but it's, I think, more to the point, it is an Isis temple. And, you know, effectively, I mean, she will shortly change her name to the Virgin Mary. But that's what this is. I'm the mother of Horus, and Horus is, you know, Horus is the Christ. There's no argument about that, really. Anyway, as I said, the temple was moved stone by stone, and we'll see it in a little bit, the other island where it was. But my belief is, and there was an architect on an earlier trip who was really interested in doing this, but I couldn't, without going to a lot of extra trouble, get the plans that I needed. But my sense of this is that, I mean, it's the only other temple that's built upon a skewed axis. As you see, it goes in this way, and then there's another axis that goes this way. And that this is the temple of woman in the same sense that Luxor is the temple of man. And there's some internal evidence that's very suggestive of that. One, this looks like legs, a lot like legs. And normally, what's called a mimesi, we pointed it out a couple of times, the Hyla did, without explaining much. Mimesi means birth house. And in other Ptolemaic temples, I think it is a Ptolemaic device. It doesn't exist earlier. And, oh yeah, I didn't, I mean, I was going to, and I got sidetracked, that just as in Old Kingdom Egypt, it's the great creator god, Ra, Ptah, and Atum, who are the focus of the religion, and then in New Kingdom, Middle Kingdom, New Kingdom times, it's Amon, the animator of form, in other words, the organic universe, and then it shifts again in Ptolemaic times, very specifically around 300 or so BC, to the Isis, Osiris, Horus cycle, which then becomes Christianity. So, in other words, then it's a shift of focus. It's basically, when it becomes that, it's the role of humanity, or the supposed role of humanity, within the grand cosmic scheme. So, for whatever reason, and I'm not at all sure why that's it. So, in other Ptolemaic temples, the Mimesi, the birth house, where the scenes are shown of the birth of Horus, is exterior to the temple itself. But here, it's inside the temple, and it's right inside. Did you go down that aisle and then off to the left? Did people get in there, in that little shrine there? Well, that's the Mimesi. This is where Horus is born. And if these are the legs, that's the womb. And the symbolism enforces that, because on that wall there are the seven columns, number of one of the numbers of Hathor Isis, and I think there are the seven Hathors playing their frame drums, in other words, celebrating the birth, and in the deeper metaphysical sense, the primordial scission, the rupture of the infinite, and the initiation of the manifest. And then on the other side, the columns, there are 10 columns, symbolic of Horus. So this is a pretty good beginning, but the trick would be to get a plan of the temple, and it has to be a no fooling around plan, not something out of the guidebook, my guidebook or any others, but something that's really to the millimeter. And there would be such a thing, because UNESCO, when they moved the temple, would have had such a plan, they would have had to have had such a plan in order to reconstruct the temple from scratch. So it really is just a question of going through the bureaucracy to see if you could get hold of such a plan. It probably would not be that difficult, or at least through my various, let's say, semi-official connections, I should be able to do it. But I haven't done it because I'm too busy with other things. But it really would be a really interesting study. I mean, that's another PhD, and it's one that you could, I mean, they don't accept that the temple of man is the temple of man, but everybody but them if you came up with the same kind of evidence that Trawler came up with in Luxor, I mean, you'd make your case without too much trouble. Already, that the birth house is in the place of the womb. This is unmistakable, but should be able to find elsewhere in the reliefs other subtler but supporting pieces of evidence. So, you know, another project that's still to be realized. Let's see. Otherwise, you notice again, there's a funny one inside, back to the self-effacing Egyptians. Over here on this side, they're almost left intact, except for the ones at the top at the very end. So why do they leave the other ones empty, uneffaced? And on the bottom, those figures of of Horus and Isis. I'm not sure if that's Hathor or Isis, but wearing the Hathor horns, completely untouched, and the ones over on this side, carefully effaced. And unfortunately, nobody has my guidebook with them, do they? Damn, I left it in the hotel, because there's a funny little paragraph. I'll have to, by memory, but it's not as good as when I do it by memory, inside on this question of effacements. Anyhow, there is obviously a method to the madness, and the stone lions are very un-Egyptian, but they are done in they're from Roman times. If they were earlier, they'd probably be sphinxes, but they're Roman, and exactly what they signify, who put them there, I don't know. Anyway, let's go into our Mimisi there and take a look at the reliefs, some of which are significant, a few other interesting architectural points there. And I must say, I do not think I can remember a time coming here, and we're an hour into being here, and there isn't a single other person. That's pretty amazing. Isis is taking good care of us, but not very good care of the Egyptians.
Basically, Egyptians and Italians.
Yeah. Oh, but compared to, it's really, as engineering goes,
the graffiti of Napoleon. This was the last temple. This the mission of Napoleon reached, because they started doing every temple and every site from the north all the way. That's the last one.
Yeah. Well, they were surveying. The Egypt as accurately as they possibly could, which by this time is pretty accurate, in order to determine the circumference of the earth, and thereby from that was derived, I'm not sure if it was the meter was derived from that study or if they were doing the study in order to justify the
the mission?
In order to justify the meter as the standard measure of the French Empire, and by extension, since Napoleon had grand plans, of the world. And there are very complex reasons why the meter doesn't serve that function very well. It serves certain functions very well, but certain others not so well. It has to do with it being derived from a circular measure, as opposed to linear measures of the cubit and so on, which stem from different sources. This stuff is very complicated, and I understand it when I read it, but I don't understand it well enough to retransmit it. But it doesn't matter. Anybody sufficiently interested, I can give the references, and you can chase it down.
Did you see the where the water was in one time?
We see it better inside. Yeah.
The water went here, then up, then totally submerged in the water.
On the other side or this side?
All over.
Follow.
The temple was under the water in one time.
But in this location?
Yeah.
No, in the other location.
Ah. This is a higher island, and they have cut the contours of it to resemble the one original one. Flashlight. flashlights, guys. See, the water washed here in that van. Water. This is... The two Nubian gods, Ankit and Sartit. That's a flash at
Paris. So here is Horus being, you know, was born and being, you know, sequestered in the, that's good flash, in the papyrus, and the papyrus reads, papyrus swamp, Moses in the bulrushes, below here is Isis in the robe of Mary, and you see that little Horus is sitting on her lap. Now, a peculiarity of this is if you look closely here, it's a bit indistinct. Oh yeah, that's better. You see that Horus is not proportioned as a baby. The Egyptians understood proportion. So if they wanted to sculpt an actual baby, they would be perfectly capable of doing this, but they don't. Mm-hmm. Presumably because Horus is, he doesn't really have a childhood. He is what he is. And Jesus, in this tradition of painting, or of painting and I guess sculpture, I don't know about sculpture, but in painting anyway, showing the infant Jesus as a kind of wizened old man goes into the Renaissance, particularly early Renaissance. They don't start showing the infant Jesus as a baby until Victorian times when they invent the chocolate box. But it has a totally different significance with the Egyptians evidently. Applied deliberately because as art, it's a very curious device showing a little baby as a wizened old man. Anyway, it's a fact that's how he's portrayed. And elsewhere, I don't see it here.
John, I like to, first of all, you see how it washed away the smoke and the dirt, the water when it flooded until here for a while. Second, this is a Ptolemy, who is giving very interesting shape of flower bouquets as offering to whom? To this triad. And this triad is a Nubian team of gods. It's Khnum and two of his wives. One here has a white crown with two horns, you see? Her name is Satet. And this one, I love her lovely fan-like head, so beautiful. And you only see her, Aswan, and then to Nubia, Ankit and Sartit, right? You see them. You're going to notice them now in Abu Simbel, and that's the last one we see together in Upper Egypt, right? So this is the Mamizi, as John explained.
Something I wanted to mention here. Oh yeah, elsewhere, not here, but we'll see it. You'll see Isis suckling Horus, the Horus on her lap, you know, seated, not here, kneeling on a base, and you'll see her breastfeeding Horus exactly as a Egyptian Renaissance Madonnas are portrayed, and of course
they're
all.
Isn't this the way, John? When he's sitting on her.
No, but you don't see that where she's kneeling like that. You see her seated. And I mean, there are only X number of ways in which a woman can suckle a baby, but that tradition, it's rigorously adhered to over the course of the Renaissance, in which actually Khnum up there who creates. Mankind and Ishikor.
And gods. Yeah.
And
man, he creates.
But on the potter's wheel.
Yeah.
So you have, you know, the old Adam, you know, Adam creating, what is it, how does the clay, where does the clay come in? God creates.
And
then there's the rib, yeah, but originally, I mean, the first stage is creating
from the earth,
from clay, right?
The rib is better than the clay.
you can get lamb chops that. In fact, there's a good joke of mine. Metaphysical jokes are few and far between, but there's one in which the geneticists and the biologists get so filled with themselves, and genetics has reached such a point that they decide that God is unnecessary. So they go and get an audience with God to tell him that his services are no longer required. And they're going to challenge him to, you know, create a human being out of clay. And God accepts that challenge, and the scientist reaches down, grabs a handful of clay, and God says, "No, no, 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 no! Make your own goddamn clay." that's a profound joke.
John, yeah. I never noticed this before, and I think we should look at it in a way, you know, general way. John, when we go to the sanctuary, we're going to talk about the vulture that is mm-hmm. the head. But here, have you ever seen Isis holding the baby like modern days? You know, it's with the hand and tapping his head.
No.
And also, here it shows the king in a young form, child. And children in Egypt, they have signs like the lock of youth and naked. So the child here is Horus. Ah, it's the king, and he's Horus, and that's the mother. And it's very important to, when we go to the sanctuary, to talk about the vulture headdress. There is a lot of maternity scenes here.
Yeah, well, it's birdhouse, it's what?
Yeah, there are over there.
Okay.
The bed.
See these little reference plugs here, which you see all over the place. See? Mm. That's the surveyors are hammering those in. Presumably, you got a line straight, but why on earth they don't take them out once they. Over, you know where?
I think so.
Over by, you go through, you come out of here.
Yeah. Go to the left, there is a huge tree under the bush. You have a change for the toilet?
I have some.
It was talking about the legacy of the virgin birth
yeah.
Christianity. And how it comes from Isis. And in the original story, the baby was born next to Isis' farm.
Well, that's cool.
Maybe the part of the story.
Okay. Here. No, John. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, well. Okay, so this is the court here, and this is, as you see, that's the mummy, see, where Horus is born, and you see the seven Hathor columns, undamaged, I think, are they? Left completely alone. Is there eggs in the ear or not? Can anybody see?
There? Oh yes, yes, yes.
There are.
Yeah, yeah.
And all of them?
No, not well. Yeah. I think so. Yeah.
And all of them.
Yeah. They're all ovulating.
Well, this is. There's an interesting study in there because the egg is in the ear. You can't miss that. But why is it sometimes and sometimes not? That would be a worthy, you know, better than Tutankhamun's laundry list. But there are seven of them there, and there they are on the wall of the mummy, see, beating their frame drums, the seven Hathors representing the rupture. The circle. And here, the ten columns, symbolic of Horus. That strange big stela there. I mean, everything, every bit of this has been moved from the other island.
That is the stela of Nexanebo, who's the last Egyptian-born pharaoh before Alexander takes over. And it details something, do you know, so how I forget, it's the,
yes,
the priest
it's
of
about
Phanum.
A few, basically it's about the famine that took place during Imhotep and Zoser time.
Right, right, the ancient famine, yeah.
Right, in the third dynasty, 2700 BC, the builder of the step pyramid, when we go to Saqqara. So, and he was saying how the river has flooded again when Imhotep, the genius, the great one, suggested, I think it was the first time, to do offerings in the river in this part of the world, of Egypt, where mythologically they think the river started here, so they did offerings, and then there was no famine anymore.
Yeah, that's that also invites further study to see if there's any sort of physical evidence for such a famine, or if it has a more profound
it's
symbolic.
Recurring. It had happened a few times in the history.
It happened a few times, I know, but going back to Imhotep is a long way away from Nectanebo, so it's interesting that that carries forward. I just don't know. Anyway, the rough granite here, you see, obviously brought over, and in a temple in which everything is fairly meticulously finished, they're leaving that granite there on purpose, and I'm pretty sure, studied it, that it would have, it's a parallel to the roughly dressed granite drums that we saw in Dendera, actually hearkening back or symbolizing Sekhmet, Hathor's Sekhmet nature, the other side of Sekhmet, as the raging lioness. That's her in her fiery form. Now here, this is another one of those, my favorite, absolute favorite parts of the temple in terms of the effacing idea, the self-effacing Egyptians, as you see. And the eastern facade here, absolutely untouched. And on the western facade, meticulously hammered out. And in the guidebook, I quote, as an Egyptologist who worked here for decades, and they did, these guys, I mentioned this, they stake out a particular temple and they spend 10 years, 20 years, 30 years studying every bit and piece of it. And unfortunately, I don't have the guidebook with me, but it's a very emotional passage, just a paragraph in which he's talking about, he's semi-quoting it, and then these hippies of the new faith, the Christians, streaming out of their distant hermitages, would come to Philae to consummate their fanatical work of destruction, destroying these wonderful images in their view perverse, and by what miracle did anything survive? Well, by what miracle? It was completely left untouched. I mean, guy worked there for 20 years and doesn't notice that the damned reliefs are still damned over there, and the others have been tap, very carefully hammered out. This betrays, and the language is better. I mean, I'm quoting a little bit, but it's more ecstatic and more ridiculous in its original. You'd think that somebody along the line would notice this. I mean, this is not me being
a
genius.
We notice it, and they say that the effacers got sick and tired,
They left it. Yeah. What is it?
That's our doctors in the university. When I asked them, they told me so.
Yeah, chapter 73 of the Effacers Union got everyone together and said, okay, guys, we down tools here if we don't get a raise. Guys.
John, can I ask you about this?
Of course.
This big granite kind of oval shape.
That's what I was talking about.
Nexanebo.
John?
But it's a very peculiar, it's pretty odd actually, because it's been cut. That's not, it's totally
original.
It's cut
in the natural granite of the original temple, as much as that.
You think? See?
Yeah.
Yeah?
That's part of the granite.
But, I know, but it's strange in that it's cut off at the top. You know, it's not a normal-looking stela, commemorative stela, which has a distinct shape.
It's contouring the original thing. But why do you think, why is it very hard from Imhotep to be passed to Nectanebo? These people kept the tradition and the papyrus and the stories. Actually, do you remember the New Kingdom guys who went and did graffiti in the Abu Saqqara? Uh-huh. So they kept it. It's going on.
They did keep it, but it's pretty.
John,
yes.
Before we move on, I wanted to call your attention to something. Just right here.
Right.
Could it be a fetus?
I was taking a nap over there and I was looking up at this arch of the.
Could it be a fetus?
What? Wait. No, wait a second. Let me see.
I was looking up at the arch of the doorway, and there's these depictions of vultures, and I was like, just laying there, and I was like, oh, their talons look like the bottom of the wasp there, so much, right? But whatever. I was like, okay, well, they're a horseshoe shape. And then I stood up, and this column right here has a picture of the vulture leaning over, and right in front of it is a wasp with a vulture's head, and its foot is the bottom of the wasp, the vulture's foot itself.
Oh.
Yeah. That's it's right here, yeah.
That's right.
And I was like, whoa, that's uncanny.
That's
significant.
Kakaiwa discovered.
Yeah.
It blew my mind. And there's a vulture and a cobra facing each other. We both have a wasp in front of them.
Yeah.
Over and over again. Here's the first one. In the middle, there's an ankh, and its foot is the wasp here.
Yeah,
but then,
it is a vulture.
There's a better one over here.
Mood.
Right here.
Yeah.
Mood.
I can't really see that. Here's the wasp scepter.
Yes.
Here's the foot of the vulture, and they overlap.
Yeah.
Right. And then here's again the cobra and the vulture. The cobra has the infinity, and the wasp scepter has
that.
That's
a beauty, this one.
And then on the other side of this thing, once again, is the vulture, and its foot is the other side of the wasp scepter.
And look, Akaiwa, the shin ring is overlapped also by the wasp. It's an.
Yeah, there's the wasp scepter penetrating through the ankh, actually.
Yeah,
no,
and here too.
That's the shin ring.
Yeah, shin ring.
Yeah.
Here too. And then its foot, the vulture foot again. Right here.
Is the talon.
Yeah.
Listen, it's as good, at least as good as any other explanation I've heard.
It's all around this column, the whole way around.
Trouble with the Ptolemaic stuff is that it is pretty crude. And you have to look for something, you know, more elegantly realized than this. But it is.
It's a little dude.
It is? Yeah. It's very interesting.
And then in there, you can see the ceiling of that is what first like got me on it, because I was sleeping looking up at that thing. And those vulture feet look they're made just in that shape.
Let's see there. Oh yeah, called the Ushanians. It's interesting. Could be.
Yeah, I thought it was nothing, but I stood up and looked right.
Yeah, could be. As is so often the case, when the Egyptian religion disintegrates, the church takes over, and as is so often the case, occupies particularly sacred parts of the temple, in this case the hypostyle hall, where Horus is sequestered and raised to manhood. And so here they cut in, I keep forgetting, I think that's a Byzantine cross. But that one over there is not a Byzantine cross.
This looks more like
it looks Celtic, really, but it isn't.
But it's Byzantine. It doesn't look very, very different.
Well,
this is more elaborate.
Well, it looks a lot different. Anyway, and then they cut in, and they take a piece of the temple and make an altar out of it. And then they, as you see, there's a niche there. It probably would have had a nativity scene of some sort or another. And
this became a church.
So it becomes a church. Now, one of my, and there are some scenes, there are certain pieces in here where they're reconstructed and they're upside down.
Stones, right here?
Stones, I think so. Stones or the reliefs are upside down. Some weird things. And anyway, in one of my early lectures, of early visit, because a guy comes running up to me, because you see graffiti all over the place, and is laughing, and he says, have you seen this?
John, before, this place kept on the worship of ISIS even when Egypt became all total Christian, right? And the priests here kept on the worship of ISIS, and ISIS was still going on, and in Nubia in the south, with all the rituals, this place was like a castle, very well protected with the water and the way it's built.
Actually, it's not the least bit well protected, because it's in the middle of an island that's 100 meters from the shore. I mean,
split. Anyway, they kept it on, and they did not surrender to the rest of the Egyptian worship.
For whatever reason, they're allowed to perpetuate the ISIS thing, because it's the easiest thing in the world for a couple of squads of soldiers to take over the island. There's
but
no
they
protection
left
whatsoever. Exactly, they left them for whatever reason.
For some time, and it's the last stronghold of Egyptian religion and practice until what is his name? The Byzantine, Constantine.
That's much earlier, till Theodosius, one of the crazy Byzantine emperors, swooping through 460 AD, I think it is.
5th century.
But it's going until then, which is weird, because everywhere else it's died centuries ago. It's not as though it's just a few weeks or a few years. It's a lot. But they're allowing it to persist. Why? We don't know. Anyway, over here,
that's
really interesting graffiti. He's showing me, did you see this? And he's showing me this. Thing over here. Oops. Thank you. This graffiti here, B. Muir, cuts in his name, and somebody comes along afterwards and says, Stultus est. I don't really have Latin, so, but he says, I'm a Latin teacher. That means is stupid. And of course, so is the guy who puts he is stupid in. He's just as guilty as Monsieur Muir. But in fact, one of the guys on the very recent trip somehow knew who B. Muir was, who was apparently not just a grockle coming by, but a scholar of some note. And I forget exactly what he said, but it was something very interesting, and I had something I have to look up, because Mr. Muir was, as I said, it was a scholar or a personage of some consequence back in whenever it was that he's doing this, probably 1830s or 40s or something like that. Now, over here, there's another one of the
But what about the movie you wanted to help make?
Oh no, I'll talk about that when we go into where the last hieroglyphs are. Over here, this is the French are coming through with their surveying team, and they're leaving a note. You know, the record of their surveying. Now, when they wanted to, they were collecting money, UNESCO, to move the temple. The French didn't want to contribute anything to it because there was nothing French about it. And then they pointed out in the surveying team was their famous writer, Honoré de Balzac. So he's there, and so the French had to chip in a few francs to do their bit to the rescue effort.
And Balzac reached this place in the end of a measurement from Paris, look, longitude depuis Paris, and then these are the degrees and latitude. The longitude from Paris to here, ending here, and the latitude. That's a very important mark.
Now, where's the...
You're not going?
The one, no. Well,
Alaska?
Over here?
Yeah.
Very unusual, you see.
And we are all grown ups, you can see.
Do we have a brighter one?
It's dying. Carlos, we need to... Yeah, do you have a stronger flashlight?
Anybody?
This might be
we need
strong.
To.
Let me try something for this stronger.
Oh, yeah, this is good. Okay.
Everybody's done. So,
obviously, the temple to the goddess. And the goddess then has to be pleasured. Like
here is the king.
Else. And so there you have the king, you know, Ptolemy. Tickling life out of Isis. See, they've effaced it, but you see the ankh over here. And the Egyptians were not prudish about such matters. Actually, is she portrayed deliberately looking pregnant? I'm not sure.
Well, they all have the big belly.
They all do, maybe.
Can I see?
Maybe. Anyway.
Check her pregnancy?
Pregnancy
test. Looks like she's pregnant. Yeah, but that's
Ptolemy Kunos. You've
got to wait 30 minutes until the results come. You're doing an ultrasound.
Who's this? What did I get for you? Okay, more interesting stuff now. The last known hieroglyphs.
Which is that?
Zoe, where is that thing you were talking about?
That thing, over there.
The nilometer?
I think that's a nilometer. That goes down into the water level.
Okay.
Right? I think, I'm pretty sure that's a nilometer. To measure the flood. To measure the flood.
Yeah.
Okay. It can go.
Okay.
You can see it on the walls. Here, John.
Nice and cool.
Yes, very. Yeah, always
a tunnel.
Yeah.
Ah. The weather is warmer in the morning and then it breaks.
Yeah, that was the other day like that.
Yes.
Too.
This corridor here, leads a step. Where's that? No step. But I guess it was placed in such a way that it met the water's edge, because here processions would come through, and on the other side the same is going on. And this is where, for whatever reason, we see the last known hieroglyphs. This is, of course, all Ptolemaic, but this is not. Here we have these crude little hieroglyphs, which, of course, I can't read, but really crude. You know, this is graffiti of some sort or another. And they're able to date these, maybe from the inscription, to, I think it's 480. 480 or thereabouts, A.D., and that's the end of hieroglyphs as a written system that anyone knows of. You never know, one of these days they, you know, find us a basement in Baghdad or something like that, and they find, you know, still later stuff. Anyhow, it always struck me that before, and this down here, by the way, this is also hieroglyphs, but it's demotic. Demotic is the sort of vernacular, the business transactions and so on. And that's still later, I forget when that is, but they know. And it always struck me that the fall of Philae would be a great movie script or some kind of an extended, you know, a long poem or something. I am very certain I will never get around to writing, but it's a good idea. Over here is a symbol that we haven't seen yet, where we have seen loads of empty cartouches. But this one here is not empty, but it says Per Au. Per is
is the temple, and the old great temple. It's the great house. That's what Pharaoh means, actually, the great house. And here you have the symbolic birth of the Nile. The Egyptologists insist that the Egyptians really did think that the Nile started here in Aswan, when it's well known that there are tons of pre-dynastic quarrying operations that are being carried out in Nubia and in the Sudan with hieroglyphic inscriptions saying, we, such and such a team, with mining diorite or whatever. It's kind of daffy, but here you see that symbolically, you have Hapi the Nile pouring the waters out of these vases, encircled by the giant snake vulture, or rather vulture-headed snake, which is itself under the
rocks, the island.
Yeah, under the big giant weathered rocks of the Nile. Of course, they know better than this. And here you have, actually, it looks like it's Horus, but it isn't.
It's actually
Osiris.
Yeah.
And he's associated, Osiris is always associated with, with growth. And this is a field of wheat, not a field of papyrus, which you also might expect. And this is Osiris and his role of, like, the green giant of English.
It's called Bed of Osiris.
Well, yeah, Bed of Osiris.
Then the jet.
Oh, here, a very complicated jet column. If that is true, with the one, two, the four sections of the vertebrae, that's what it's about to represent. Makes sense to me. On the other side here, more interesting reliefs, of course, very crude, Ptolemaic. But here you have the crocodiles representing death, actually. And there's the twin peaks of the horizon, typically. Solar disk in the center, and sort of sun, stars, moon on top. So it's really a very complete symbolic day-night cycle of day and night. Up here, where is that one of Shu with the...
Ahoy, John. Right here, 12 o'clock, where I am pointing. He's blowing the air in the
sea. Oh, yeah, you see that shoe blowing, the god of, or the principle of extension.
Air.
Associated with air, and blowing the sail. And over here, the only representation that I know of, it's hard to imagine that there aren't parts of them elsewhere, of Osiris, trapped in the, what kind of tree is it supposed to be? Trapped in an acacia tree? No.
It's in Lebanon.
In Lebanon.
Cedar, is it?
Cedar, probably. Here you see, where is it? Here, right here. That's Osiris, and you see that he's encased in the tree.
He's embalmed.
He's embalmed, but again, symbolizing basically that he isn't dead. He's immobilized, but he still represents the basis of life.
It's the trunk. It's the trunk. Support of the tree.
And it's only when he gets, again, this is Set's work of cutting him up into pieces. And even then, he's not dead because they get the magic phallus that they get from Sokar, so that Horus is able to be born. But the cycle itself—I mean, through all of the elaborate chapters and sequences—the main point is that spirit is trapped in matter, and its function, its cosmic function, is to free itself from the matter. And as far as we know, sometimes I wonder with the higher animals and dolphins and things like that, if they have this possibility too, and we're not understanding their language. But anyway, as far as we know, we're the only ones potentially capable of freeing ourselves from our prison of matter. Anyway, that's how I see it.
John?
So, yes?
I see quite repetitive here the symbol of the floods of the river. Yeah, listen. And then it's accompanied with, again, Shu and the sea.
Ah, yeah. Oh, yeah, Shu and the sail.
Yeah?
Anyway, yes. So let us continue.
Yes.
On the other side. Hila.
I finished today. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Karen. Gracias. Gracias. Gracias.
Appreciating it.
Here.
Now here, interesting bit, the Philae Temple, though it is entirely, oh wait till everyone gets here. Or in fact, the rest of Egypt, well, we've seen some grottoes, but Philae, as empty as this, except during the revolution itself, when we were here and we were the only tourists in all of Egypt. So this is a serious treat. Now this is a mill wheel, but it's carved out of what had been the base of a column here. So the temple as it stands is, like so many temples, was built upon what was left of earlier temples. And when they moved it, they kept it exactly as it was over there, and so it would have had this in it. But this, of course, is not an ancient Egyptian. Almost certainly it's the base of a column, a granite column, so we know from this that whatever was there earlier had granite columns, and undoubtedly, the much later Muslims take the convenient base, hollow it all out, and they have a mill wheel going around, presumably for milling grain. Anyway, it's a little bit of evidence, what the earlier construction must have entailed. Okay, continue.
Party dwarf.
Oh, yeah.
The guy from
the other
temple. Better one in here. Party dwarf.
Well, that is associated with childbirth. The celebration of childbirth. And here's Bess playing his harp and dancing, presumably to commemorate the birth of the young Horus. And over here, other party scenes as well. Here you have a very early version of the Pink Panther playing a lyre, but it really looked like it, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Absolutely the Pink Panther.
Peter Sellers, where are you?
Hmm?
Peter Sellers, where are you?
Yeah, it really is. Anyway, other scenes here. This is a little Hathor chapel, but again associated with the birth of Horus. And these are unusual. In fact, I don't know of any other instances of Bes dancing active and playing his harp. And I think, actually, even though this is crude, this is one of the ways in which the musicologists have some clues as to Egyptian music because of the fingering that they're doing here. And this isn't the only instance where they have, where they're showing the fingering. And very often, what you see is what you get. And so they could be paying careful attention to where they're placing the fingers. I don't know that they actually do that, but I know that this is one of the ways in which the musicologists have approached the otherwise impenetrable mystery of what the Egyptian music actually sounded like. My guess is that Egypt being Egypt and being, you know, so self-contained and going on for so long, it wouldn't surprise me one little bit if in the local folklore of various parts of Egypt, if some of the archaic stuff was, the archaic music was still embodied within it. But I don't, not for me to prove, but some of the musicologists might be able to determine what's new and what's Islamic and what's ancient, maybe.
And here you see Bes with the tambourine, and in the end there is a man with the flute, you see, in the corner column over there. So it's the music room since it's Hathor, because yes. Hathor, these are the associated deities or principles to Hathor, and music is also Hathor. Hathor is music and other things as
yes.
well.
So let us continue.
Let's go to
the Trajan.
John, yeah. Did most of the temples have an iolometer?
I think they all had.
Shortcut? So
that was the only way in which they could predict what, in a very accurate way, that they could predict what the harvest was going to be.
You said that was related to the taxation.
And that was related to the taxation and probably other things as well.
Now, I was wondering where, if they learned it from another source, but the Romans, the first financial product ever traded in the marketplace that's known about from what I've read, is in Rome. They created these tax obligations,
yeah.
And then they sold them to private traders in the marketplace.
Oh.
So that they had a private tax collection system. So I'm wondering, but you see, because of that, that's where the market was, wherever that was.
Right.
So I can't help but think that there's like a pretty thriving marketplace here, or wherever you have something like that.
Well, in late times, yes. Probably in early times, not. Because everything was government. Yeah, everything was under the government.
They just lift these buildings up,
sure.
Right? Just pulling these through and put it on the floor.
What?
These.
Well, that's how they lift the whole
thing. Yeah, that's what I was asking,
you get some strong guys there.
Yeah.
Oh, look,
that's the Marco stuff.
Yeah, it's
about.
Very low.
Yeah, that's
right.
There you go. Nice.
Look how much of the rock here is.
Yeah.
See?
And in terms of trade inside the temple or beds, or bureaucracy, do we know any sense of that?
You know, there might be. It's just not something I've pursued, because there are business documents and trade agreements and, you know, letters between merchants and stuff like that. Good, well, be.
The other thing, too, I can't help but think is it costs so... It's so resource-consuming to build something like this.
Well...
It kind of makes sense.
But that's not their problem. They've got lots of resources, and the food jumps out of the ground, so there's no need to... conserve such.
But think about it, like if you're, but in terms of the location of a market, because if you're bringing all this stone here, you're bringing all this labor here, you're bringing all these architects here, you're going to have a huge demand for products here, and then you're going to attract all kinds of people.
Maybe.
There must be some rest houses. And wages. Wages system and all.
And then like in Rome, there'd be a whole tax collection system being traded.
Yeah,
well, that's Rome. But this here, I don't know.
The Greek-Roman.
You know, it's, it's an area that probably is researchable.
The way I learned it in Roman history is the Romans just like started off with this idea, and that never made any sense to me because it's a pretty sophisticated idea.
Started the taxes?
Marketplaces.
The Romans would create tax obligations, then they'd sell them to private traders, which would give them the right to go collect taxes. Or
there
send
must
them, sell
have been
them to somebody
also
else.
A way in ancient Egypt when they are listing all the crops and all the fowl and
yeah, they do that. They do keep inventories of what they've got.
All of them.
I don't know.
And actually, there is always a scribe writing down
the inventories. Yeah.
Right into the tombs in Saqqara. You see that, anyway.
But what they did, you know, in other words, what the procedure was, I have no idea. Anyway, over there, and I don't remember ever seeing it quite as low as that. That's the other island.
The original island
of Philae, and the stumps that are there are the cofferdam that they built, or what's left of the cofferdam that they built so that they would be able to pump the water out to get the blocks of stone for the temple itself. Now,
And this is Trajan,
who was one of the, along with Hadrian, one of the two vaguely human Roman emperors, and they're the only ones.
Music stand.
Yeah, they're the only ones who showed any interest whatsoever in Egypt, and I think they actually visited Egypt. Whether or not this is built under the reign of Trajan, which I think is somewhere around 100 or so, 100 or so A.D., and whether or not, you know, consciously, and generated by Hadrian, I have absolutely no idea. Anyway, it's Hadrian's, it's Trajan's kiosk, and here boats would come out and there would be sort of a music stand, and boats would come and there would be celebrations and music and so on. But here, actually, there's an interesting, there's a tale, one of the tales of the 1001 Nights, and so Hila was once was telling, when we first started working together, telling me this tale that registered in a rather interesting way. So Hila will tell her. It's from the Arabian Nights, and actually there are a number of Arabian Nights stories that definitely stem from ancient Egypt, and it would be a neat study to really carefully go through the 1001 Nights and see if you found others that stemmed, that related back to still earlier times. So go ahead.
Well, the place, as you see, without even need to say, it's like a piece of paradise, the location of it, and the Nile and the scenery around it. The temple itself with the color, then the gardens then, and the fountains, and the roaming peacocks, and it was really inspiring to every piece of literature in the ancient days, to opera until recent. But this is the piece that we found in the Arabian Nights, the 1001 Nights, related to this place. It is once upon a time, there was this princess, very, very beautiful princess, daughter of the major or whatever, who ruled Aswan. And she fell in love with the gardener.
I always did. I fall in love with gardeners. All
right.
Construction workers.
And it was very hard. He couldn't. The father couldn't part them and make them stop it. So he built her the most beautiful palace here with all the commodities and servants, and he locked her here. The lover, he learned that she's locked in here, so he came, let's say, to the shore side and would cry and scream and make noise, and the crocodiles were so annoyed. So when they learned the story of why he's doing this, they pitied him, so they built a bridge with their bodies, and he stepped over the bodies, and they lived happily ever after.
That's the story. But when Sohaila told me that, I said, because there's a series of stelas, maybe we'll see them in the Cairo Museum. I have a few of them, but they're kind of hidden away, and if I don't think of it, I don't go there. But the famous one is called the Metternich stela, and it's a kind of a small, usually small, kind of granite, stela, a lot of text on it, and it depicts Horus as a young man, as a boy, with his sort of sidewalk of youth, and he is standing on at least two, but more often a bunch of crocodiles, a whole bunch of them, and in his hands he's holding a clutch of animals. He's got a cobra, and he's got a scorpion, and he's got, I forget what else, but he's also got a gazelle. And to the Egyptologists, they say, then you're supposed to pour water over this, like holy water, which captures in a little basin down below. And according to the Egyptologists, this is supposed to be a magical spell that keeps you safe among wild animals, among dangerous animals. Well, yeah, scorpions, cobras, you can understand this, but what's this saber-toothed Saharan gazelle? What's that doing there? Why should you need to be holding a gazelle? Of course, all of these creatures are under the domain of Set, and the message is that the ability, when you have it in your hand, you have them under control. Control of the Setian forces effectively means that you are immortal. You're standing on, so you're surmounting the crocodiles of death. So once it gets translated into the Arabian Night story, it's sort of the same, but it's basically love conquers all. The conquer of the crocodiles and so on. But I like that, the transmission of that. And I mean, I'd always known about this Metternich steel, about these steelers, that of course they weren't protection against wild animals, but it's fun watching it percolate down through 1001 Nights. And I think, it was an opera written about it.
And it's right? A Mugud.
Yeah, and it's a Mugud.
Yeah, and also actually this temple is a very important basic in the myth of Osiris and Isis. It's because when she had her wings on her and she flew everywhere and collected the pieces of Osiris when he was cut, she ended to this island that became her island, and her tears made the night. And the 14th, or what is it, 15th piece has been lost in here. Then he was given her husband the golden piece and impregnated her, and then Horus was consumed, or she was pregnant with Horus and continues. So it's also part of the legend, of the story of Isis and Osiris here.
And it's actually, her place. Now that you say that, the tears of Isis has a deeper significance, actually. In other words, it's her remorse over her murdered lover. In other words, the whole manifestation of life that produces the Nile, which is the new source of life. So it's not just story. You can read into it. It's deeper esoteric significance, which you usually can when you look at many of the fairy tales that we think are fairy tales. One of the reasons that they live on and will last longer than Sesame Street is that they have built into them this esoteric nature. I mean, some of them are easy to decode, Snow White and Sleeping Beauty and a number of others. Some are more difficult, some may be corrupted, some may come from elsewhere, I don't know.
But
a lot of them have this inner power. And I know when I was a kid, I never knew anything about these things, but I could read at a very early age, and what I read. But I like reading with fairy tales, not, stupid tales about, a little boy who's little and therefore is bullied by his mates. I had no interest in those, but the fairy tales rang a bell, and I would read those over and over and over. Okay, let us continue.
Get a jet. Spread your wings.
This. Where is that flag?
What is the,
they have no excuse. They have no excuse to be tired. I have an excuse. Oh, thank you. Okay, this otherwise completely unremarkable little what's left of a shrine here is dedicated to Imhotep, who in later Ptolemaic times becomes revered as a sort of as a deity or a semi-deity by the Egyptians. Before that, he doesn't have that role. He's just the great architect of, you know, the overall sort of Leonardo of his time, the genius of, not just master of all trades, not master of none. And anyway, this is an Imhotep shrine. And up here, can you see the little glancing green dot?
Yep.
That's his name, E.M., the walking reed. And then the rest of it, E.M. Hotep. His name means, they always say, Hotep means peace. Really, it's more than that. Hotep means realization. In other words, I go in, I am realized. I am complete. And anyway, that's his name is there. And over there, you have Greek or Coptic. Coptic is ancient Egyptian, but written in Greek letters with 7 or 9 additional letters to account for sounds that are not part of the hieroglyphs. And I was sitting, saying to people with me that I didn't know if that was Greek, because I don't speak Greek. I don't have Greek and I don't have Coptic. I wasn't sure if this was Greek or Coptic, not that it mattered an awful lot. But there was one lone grockle wandering around him. He said, I'm a Greek teacher, that's Greek. Okay, you now have it from an authority. Somebody asked you, what the hell was that inscription over the door of Imhotep saying, is that Greek or Coptic? You will be able to say, oh, well, that's Greek. Greek, of course. Yeah, right. Okay, guys, that's about it.
All right, let's go.